So good morning indeed, good evening everyone. It's a pleasure to be here, although only virtually. So we'd like to thank the organizers for putting up this nice workshop, very diverse. I'm learning a lot, and for giving me the opportunity so to tell you about chiral spin liquids in SUN quantum magnets. So in condensed matter theory, it's very important to understand phases of matter, in particular the most exotic ones, such as the topological phases of matter, which are, among other advantages, they are very robust in the sense of topology. And in particular, it could be useful for applications such as topological quantum computation, because you don't need any error correction. Now, of course, you need to provide a recipe how to engineer such topological phases, and you need to also to probe them to know how to detect them, in particular using topology. So, for instance, the ground state degeneracy will depend on the genesis of the manifold or of the system. The excitations can be very weird, exotic, and the entanglement properties are important. And so in this tensor network workshop, you will see that we are using a lot of these tensor network techniques precisely because of this entanglement. So just to be a bit more specific, so the excitation, I said they are exotic because the quasi-particles, as we heard already in some talks, so they are anions in the sense that they can have any statistics, so fractional statistics. That is, they are not necessarily boson or fermion because we are will be in 2 + 1 dimension, and there is no spin statistic theorem to forbid that. And not only so they can be anions, but these anions can then be abelian or not. So here is a cartoon, a famous cartoon of the, if you just know the position of the particle or quasi-particle, it's not enough to know the state of the system. You need to know the history. So you have all these braiding, fusion rules, etc. And we have a useful mathematical tool such as topological quantum field theory, such as Chern-Simons, to describe this. Now, among these topological phase, so the chiral ones have been the first found experimentally in this famous fractional quantum Hall effect. So we already saw also this measurement of quantum Hall resistance versus magnetic field with this zoo of exotic phases at specific fractions where you have a quantized Hall conductance. And the theory that we have nowadays that so most of them are abelian, so these Laughlin states, but some of them could be also non-abelian. They could also provide a route to unconventional superconductivity when you dope them, etc. So the talk today is to understand, can we get the same phase without this Landau level physics, magnetic field, etc. Because we know that phases can be adiabatically connected, so they are robust, I say, so we could deform the same phase and get into a completely different system. So one route is the talk we saw yesterday by Cécile Repelin, is to mimic this physics using other lattice models with flat bands, in particular, these topological flat bands, and this is known as fractional Chern insulator. But my talk today is on a different route to reach the same goal, to look for a lattice model, which maybe has nothing to do with fermion, et cetera, but which has a similar wave function, ground state. And so the outline of the talk will be to introduce these chiral spin liquids. I will talk about spin from now on, and to tell you about the numerical methods we use to study a family of SUN models. And here are references. So I should acknowledge, especially, so the last paper at the bottom is the one that should be submitted hopefully soon. So the hard work was done by Jiao Chen for the PEPS computation, Zhengwei Li for the DMRG, Pierre Natta for the exact diagonalization. And so I'm acknowledging also, so this work was done with Mathieu Mambrini, Didier Poilblanc in Toulouse, Keisuke Totsuka, Hong Hao Tu, Andreas Weichselbaum, Jan van Delft, and also others in previous works that I will also mention. Okay, so we have this cartoon of fractional quantum Hall effect. We have a 2D electron gas, and we have this chirality because we have an edge mode, which is only in one direction, so it's very robust. So we have a cartoon, let's say, of a nu equal 1/2 fractional quantum Hall state. So it's gapped in the bulk, incompressible, if you prefer. The excitation are fractional of the fundamental charge, so it's 1/2. And we have this robust chiral edge mode, which is described by your conformal field theory, SU2 level 1. Now, can we get the same on the lattice spin 1/2 model? So if you think about Heisenberg, spin one half interacting on some lattice. So in the seminal work by Kalmeyer and Laughlin in 1987, they suggested that indeed on the triangular lattice, you could get maybe the similar properties, meaning so gapped in the bulk, fractional excitation, but here the fraction is because it's a spin one half. Of course, it's neutral. We have a spin system. There's no charge. And also this chiral edge mode described by the SNCFT. So unfortunately for the triangular lattice, it did not work out, but it was a very inspiring paper, of course, that that has motivated further studies. So as we saw in this cartoon, so this chiral spin liquid is a lattice analog of this fractional contour mole effect. So they should break the same symmetry. So they break time reversal symmetry, they break the parity or reflection, if you prefer. And they have this protected edge mode. So in the terminology of Shougang-Wen, it's really the strong topological states which have this long-range entanglement that can be difficult to handle by many techniques, but for which tensor network is maybe well-suited. We have to be a bit careful, though. So there's a theorem. I mean, I think it's at the level of theorem to me, by Jérôme Dubas and Nick Reed, 2015, that prevents, in fact, for a Gaussian PEPS, so free fermion. If you think about free fermion PEPS wave function, it's impossible to have a bulk gap and with this gapless edge states. So there's a no-go theorem, at least for free fermion, and we will see what happens for interacting ones. So regarding the spin one half SU2 models that were, so as I said, by Kalmeyer and Laughlin, they suggested a triangular lattice. So in fact, it turns out that the triangular lattice, so you need to add, my pointer is maybe not working. Okay. So you need to add some extra term like this chirality, the spin chirality, the triple product of three spin on triangle. So it is SU2 invariant, but it breaks T and it breaks P. It breaks this time reversal and parity. And indeed, as soon as, because the pure J1 model is nail ordered, the anti-Fermi accord. So here you see two papers. So one is DMRG, one is exact diagonalization, plus some also Parton construction, Bach and Monte Carlo. But both are consistent in a phase diagram in the sense that you find a large region with chiral spin liquid, CSL, for this spin one half model. Similar phase was found on the Kagome lattice, the DMRG study on the Kagome lattice by Bauer et al. And Didier Paul Blanc also proposed a PEPS approach for a similar model on the square lattice. So this was for SU2. Now the goal, in this work, we have been looking to extend to SUN model. So what is the motivation to go to SUN, which is of course a much larger group with very, very interesting mathematical properties. First, it's known that it's easier to destabilize magnetic order because AI is a way analytically to, in the larger limit, to show that you can really destabilize magnetic order and go to strongly quantum phases of matter. Now, when you talk about SUN, you have to be a bit careful because there are several irreducible representations corresponding to Young tableau. And so in this talk, I will be dealing only with n color, the fundamental representation. So I have, you can think as each, at each site, I have n colors, n states for the local Hilbert space. Now SUN is not only interesting from a fundamental point of view, but also because experimentally, it could be realistic for approximately SU4 symmetry is realized in condensed matter in this graphene, twisted bilayer graphene, et cetera. And the SUN is very, it is realized almost exactly in ultra cold atomic physics for some elements called alkaline earth, simply because the nuclear spin carries a degree of freedom, which is completely uncoupled to the other during the collision. And so for instance, let me just flash some experimental papers. So if you look just at the title, the second one in the middle, it looks like ground unification, no SU2 cross SU6, but it's an experimental paper from the Takahashi group in Kyoto, in Japan, where they could mix two species of Ethereum. And at the bottom, so it's actually from Firenze. So we have a chairman from Firenze. So this was in the group of Falani. They could really populate, you have a certain number of colors and you can decide to populate a certain number. So you can really play with this SUN symmetry in the lab. Okay, so the model. It's very simple because we want SUN symmetry. We want to work on a square lattice, which has a nice C4 symmetry. So we simply put permutation. So the Hamiltonian is defined in terms of permutation. at each site, you have colors and colors, and you simply make permutation. So J1 is on nearest neighbor, J2 is a frustration on the diagonal, and then you have a three-body term, which is a three-body permutation. And it has some imaginary parts. It's Hermitian, of course, but meaning that it breaks explicitly the time reversal and parity. We have some parametrization, but the phase is quite robust, so I will only show results for some specific choice of parameters. And let me also mention a related model on the triangular lattice that was studied by Nataf and co-workers. Okay, so the numerical methods. Of course, we can start with exact normalization, which is the fully unbiased, but limited in size. And here for SUN, not only we can use the color conservation, so the abelian symmetries corresponding to U1, but we can also make use of the full SUN symmetry as advertised by Pierre Nataf and Frédéric Millard, because here these are the Hilbert space size of the singlet space for some SUN and some lattices. So if you go, for instance, to SU10 on 20 sites, so of course you don't have many singlets, because if you think about it, of this color, a singlet has no color. So you need, for instance, 10 sites to make an SU. For SU10, you need 10 sites to make a singlet. So on 20 sites, you have only a few 10,000 of singlets. While if you don't consider this full SUN symmetry, but only the color conservation, the sectors are much larger and completely unfeasible on the supercomputer. The second technique we use is DMRG. So again, in DMRG, you can only use abelian symmetries, which are always easy, but you can also use the full SUN symmetry. And to boost the convergence, we use this proposal by Ongao Tu, Lei Wang, and Yingai Wu to use a projected Fermi C as a starting point for your DMRG, because it has a nice MPO representation. So you take fictitious fermion. So here it's for spin 1/2, for instance. You make a chain insulator, I mean a band calculation. You populate your band, and then you make a Gutzwiller projection. So it gives you a starting spin wave function. And last but not least, we use the PEPS again. In this, we can use either only U1 symmetry, but also the full SUN symmetry. So the full SUN symmetry, I should acknowledge, we use this Q space library developed by Andreas Weichselbaum, where all the tensors are, all the contractions make use of this Clebsch-Gordan calculations. A few more words on the PEPS. So actually, Mandrini, Horus, and Poil Blanc, they propose to classify. So the basic object in the PEPS calculation is this local tensor. We have a virtual space, which is a direct sum of, let's say, for SU2 of spins. And we can use also the irreducible representation of the point group symmetry of your lattice. And if you do that, you have very few tensors, in fact. You can really classify them. So at the end of the day, the most general chiral PEPS and that, for instance, will be just to combine different irets, A1 and A2, in the C4V classification. And you have very few coefficients to optimize. So it's very beneficial for optimization. And you can generalize that question. Okay, so let me show the results. So for all techniques, so exact divergence on a torus, the prediction is to have an n-fold degenerate ground state. So this is what is found here. So you have the excitation energy for various SUN on different systems, always in the singlet sector. And then above in gray area, these are the excited states. So of course, the degeneracy is not perfect, huh, because we are in a finite system, but it's quite good. I remind you that in two dimensions, we have a generalization of the Lib-Matty theorem, so by Oshikawa and Hastings for SU2, but that can be also generalized to SUN. So it's impossible for this system here to have a single non-degenerate gap state. So you have to break either lattice symmetry or to be topological. Now, not only you can get that from exact normalization, but we can also look at the quantum numbers of all these states, this manifold of degenerate, quasi-degenerate ground state, because the momenta can be obtained from a counting rule coming from a generalized Pauli principle known in the fractional chain insulator community, so from Alden, Bernevic, Renu. And here is some example, for instance. So this is, again, excitation energy for SU4 on 20 sites, but this time you can see the four states, you can see their momenta. And they are really non-trivial, so at some specific point in the Brillouin zone, and completely predicted by this count. And you can do several other examples, so SU7 on 14 sites, etc. Not only you can look at the singlet physics, but you can do the quasi-all, which is very interesting because so you simply change the size of your cluster. Now you have a quasi-all on the system. And in this case, the degeneracy is much larger. It's equal to the number of sites, so much larger than the previous N. And the prediction, the counting is, in the cases we've looked, and so it's one state per momentum sector. And this is here in orange. So again, excitation energy. So this is SU4 on a 19-site cluster, periodic, on a torus. You have a huge degeneracy, so one state per momentum. And you see the quasi-degeneracy is very good. Similarly here, SU7 on 13 sites, etc. And the last thing we can do with exact aggregation is to play with topology. So we can take an open cluster. I think we also saw that yesterday by Cécile. We can take this kind of droplet. So it's an open cluster. And so, of course, now we can only label the states according to their angular momentum. And so we have this very nice chiral branch. So they have a kind of linear dispersion. You can see, so this has, these are several examples of SU5 and SU6, but we have plenty of other values on different clusters. And the point here, I don't want, of course, you to look into all details, but is that the CFT gives you the counting and the structure of this chiral branch. So you know all the multiplets that should appear, and you have a perfect correspondence, perfect agreement. So it's a very convincing evidence already on small system that you have this, this topological phase for this model. Okay, now I go to this tensor network. So the first is to use this DMRG. So here I'm a bit more specific about this trick by Wu, Wang, and Tu. So we have a Parton construction. So here you see some bands of a fermionic model with a chair number in the bottom negative energy state. You also see the crossing at zero, which tells you about this edge state because the calculation is done on the cylinder this time. And now you can populate this and you can make use of this edge state to construct different starting points to target different excitations. And again, DMRG is, of course, you will get the entanglement spectrum for free in your calculations. So you can plot it. And here are two examples for SU3 and SU4. So this is the entanglement spectrum of the cylinder versus the transverse momentum, which is like an angular momentum of this cylinder. And you have again this very nice dispersing, linear dispersing chiral branches that corresponds to a CFT counting of this corresponding SUN. Just for the expert, the subtlety is that because we are using SUN DMRG, if you think about SU2, you see the edge state, you would like to have a speed up and a spin down, but it's not a singlet. Of course, if you want to have the full SU2 symmetry, you need to entangle these edge states. And so you have some extra entanglement across this bond. So when you cut the system in two, you will get some extra structure. So at the end, you get two copies of the conformal towers. So that's why if you really look into it, look at the panel in the middle, maybe you see that the zero energy state at the bottom, you have both a singlet and an adjoint representation. Now the PEPS construction. So I told you that we want to use the symmetric PEPS construction. So we need to specify the virtual space. So it's a direct sum of all possible representation of SUN with one column. Okay, so this is a choice. And now the tensor will be this on the tensor A on site will be a linear map from the virtual space on all the four virtual space to the physical one. And we also have the B tensor on the bond to make sure that we get a singlet for this PEPS wave function. And since we want to describe this chiral spin liquid that breaks P and T but not the combination, we use this combination of linear superposition of tensors after classification. So we have very few coefficients, and the optimization is performed using a CTMRG and a gradient optimization. But I really emphasize for SU3 is like 10 coefficients, and maybe SU4 is order 30, but the number of coefficients is really reduced because of the symmetry classification. So with PEPS, it's also very natural to compute entanglement properties. So we can compute on a cylinder, an infinite cylinder with a given NV, number of sites on the width. We can compute the reduced density matrix. And indeed, we know from Lee and Haldane that the entanglement spectrum should give us information about the CFT of the boundary spectrum. And in fact, it's exact for PEPs. It was pointed out in this paper by Sirac, Poil-Blanc, Schur, and Förstrette, that in fact, it's exact in the sense that there is an isometry. So you get the same spectrum if you compute the entanglement spectrum of half an infinite system or the physical of the on the boundary. And so we can compute this, and here again, so this is SU3 on a, with six cylinder, and you can see this beautiful chiral branch, and all the symbols here are multiplets of SU3, so the singlet, the adjoint, and other EREPs as a function of the transverse momentum, and you exactly recover the CFTs, of course, when you get to high energy, you start having a mixing with other states because the system is not infinite. And you can do the same for SU4. Here, the width is a bit reduced, it's only four, but you see the size of the, using the full SUN symmetry, it's a way to really push the calculation, because when you do this corner transfer matrix renormalization group, the control parameter is this chi value. So here you can go to value of chi, which are several times d squared, as needed for good convergence, but d squared is quite large because we have a large virtual space. Also for the expert, if you can notice some duplication of some chiral branch. So if you look, for instance, on the panel B, so you have several, not only one CFT branch, but several that that are due also to some maybe artifact in this.
Can I ask a question for to that?
Yeah, I mean, you should know.
I have a very specific question. In the SU4 case, is this duplication exact or approximate? Because in the SU2 case, it's exact, and we understand why it's there, right? Yes. In the SU3 case, it's approximate, which means there is no reason in some sense, at least no reason in terms of asymmetry. That's why I'm curious.
No, actually, that's something I would like to discuss with you maybe later. Because for SU3, it was not even in the singlet sector, as you see on the left panel. But here for SU4, even in the singlet sector, there's duplication, and it's not exact.
Okay, that's
not, so we should discuss that, I think we don't have a... Okay. Maybe just quickly to about this no-go theorem, because with PEPs you can also compute correlation length. So either you really compute correlations, as done on the left panel for SU3, so Vison, Spinon, spin correlation, and then you extract the correlation length, or you can get directly the correlation length from the transfer matrix. And of course, both calculations agree very well. But if you plot this correlation versus your control parameter, which is this dimension during the CTMRG, chi, you see that it's not saturating. So presumably it's gapless indeed, as I told you, for free fermion. So it's positive. I mean, for the mathematical community, I think it would be very interesting to think about, an extension of this theorem to interacting PEPs. So is it true that we cannot get a PEPs for chiral state? Apparently this is what we find always. Last point maybe is to just emphasize some works by colleagues that you can also find maybe the same phase without the T breaking, an explicit T breaking. So it can be spontaneously broken. This was found, for instance, for SU2 on extended Kagome-Eisenberg. This was found on, now on Hubbard lattice, Hubbard model on triangular lattice, so in the kind of intermediate correlated regime. So when U is not very large, it looks like effectively a spin model with multi-spin interaction. So that could also favor this chiral spin. I think I should stop now.
You still have about 5 minutes if you want to go.
Okay, so maybe I can show you quickly what we have done on the non-abelian case. For SU2, in the fractional contour effect, there is a famous proposal like Moore, Rydstate, Reid-Rezaei, and they have again incompressible gaps in the bulk, but they have non-abelian fractional excitation, as I showed with these Brayton groups, etc. And the CFT is SU2 some higher level, so SU2 level 2, level 3. So again, the same question: can we do the same with spin? So we need to construct a parent Hamiltonian. There are alternative approaches using coupled wire construction. So I haven't listed all the references, but there have been several works trying to find that. The interesting properties of this topological phase is, for instance, that SU2 level 2 have these easing anions, which are non-abelian and can be interesting. So the strategy is to use a parent Hamiltonian construction. So here is a paper by Glasser and co-workers. They propose a parent Hamiltonian, but it's very complicated, the long range, many terms. I mean, it's not something you want to study numerically. But because it's a robust phase, in principle, we can truncate this and hope to get in the same phase. So this is what we did. We took a simple spin one model on the square lattice. So you can see all the terms. So for spin one, you have bilinear, biquadratic. You also have this spin chirality, and it has the symmetry of the square lattice. And then, of course, you need numerics because you have done a serious approximation here. And so the numerics, I will go quickly. So this is a paper with Jiao Chen, Lawrence van der Stretten, and Didier Poil-Blanc. So we did the combination of exact domination. So you expect three states for SU2 level 2 on a torus. But it's not super conclusive because the system is rather small. But fortunately, so you can use these PEPs. So here is a very nice computation of correlation showing that okay, you may have a very small, I mean, you may be critical, again, for the same reason as before, but still it has very small weight in this correlation. So it's maybe not a problem, I mean, to analyze. And it comes from maybe this NOGO theorem. It's an interacting PEP, so we don't know, but it's probably not a problem. In particular, you can extract the edge entanglement very nicely, and you see these similar branches as before. Except that this time, if you look at the counting of the multiplets, it's what is predicted by Wes Zmino-Witten SU2 level 2 conformal field theory. Okay, so as a conclusion, I tried to show you that we can construct simple SU1 spin models on the square lattice that can stabilize this topological chiral spin liquid. It's important to combine different numerical techniques. I think it was emphasized already on the first day by Steve White. And these days in the community, we try really to combine different techniques because they all have their strengths and weaknesses. Here, we characterize mostly the edge states using entanglement properties, which are well-suited for tensor network techniques. And now the roadmap would be need to crank up and go to this non-abelian chiral spin liquid. So SU2 level 2, we already did, and we have these easing anions. But we want to go further because SU2 level 3 already has some very interesting Fibonacci anions that could allow universal computation in these quantum computers. And we could go also to other SUN higher level, etc. And so here are the references, and I thank you for your attention.